Hi, and welcome to Module 4 of the SQL Server for Oracle DBAs. In this module, we will look at the data objects that are available in both platforms. Let's start by looking at tables as the main objects that store our data. We will also look at the various types of indexes, data types. We will compare storage level architecture and compare various table types between SQL Server and Oracle. Let's start by looking at tables and comparing different table types that are available in both Oracle and SQL Server. In both Oracle and SQL Server, the most popular table type is a heap. Heap is a table that does not have any particular logical organization. So it's just a collection of pages without any order of rows stored on those pages. In SQL Server, the second most important type of table is a clustered index table. So a table with a clustered index created on it. In Oracle, the equivalent is the index organized table. In addition to that, Oracle offers clustered table. That functionality maps into SQL Server index view, at least partially. Other types of tables include nested table. Nested table is not implemented in SQL Server, although you can implement some of that functionality using XML data type. Both Oracle and SQL Server also offer temporary tables. Session level temporary tables as well as global temporary tables are available in SQL Server. The functionality of Oracle's external table can be implemented using SQL Server linked servers. Linked servers allow you to implement a data source, an external data source to which you can against which you can run your queries. Both Oracle and SQL Server also offer the ability to partition tables. I will demonstrate how to create a partition table in SQL Server in just a few minutes. So, heap is the default form of data organization with no particular order. The opposite of that is a SQL Server clustered index or the Oracle index organized table. In SQL Server, objects often have more than one allocation unit. The reason for that is that apart from the rows stored in their own allocation unit, SQL Server stores certain large data types, LOBs, in the separate allocation unit. So your index or table can have multiple allocation units, as I will demonstrate in just a few moments. SQL Server also offers data compression. You can compress data in your tables and indexes in a way that allows you to fit more rows on a single page so that your indexes are smaller, they take less memory, and they take less I/O to access from disk. This is a very important functionality, especially for large databases or data warehouses. Let's take a look at the allocation unit metadata that is available for one of our tables. So, in this somewhat complicated query, I am querying SIS system internals allocation units, which is one of the catalog views containing information about allocation units. I'm joining with it with sys partitions to retrieve information about individual index partitions, with sys indexes and then sys index columns and sys columns to retrieve information about individual columns that are present in a particular index. And I'm querying for a particular object called person. So I'm interested in all the indexes and all their partitions and all their allocation units for that particular object. If I run this query, you can see that we have three different indexes on that table. We have the PK person business entity ID. We have the IX person last name, first name, middle name with three separate columns. And then finally, we have the AK person row GUID index. So we have three separate indexes. Out of those, one of the indexes is a clustered index. So a clustered index is actually the table itself, just like Oracle index organized table, where the index is not separate from the table itself. It's the table organized into an index structure. But you may notice that despite the fact that the index is on a single column, we actually have three separate allocation units for that index. That's because apart from the in-row data, which are the normal rows in our table, we also have the lob data, large object data, and row overflow data. These are two extra allocation units that are created for our index. So in this demo, you've seen how a single object can have multiple allocation units. Let's look at the clustered index structure in SQL Server. A clustered index, just like any other index type in SQL Server, is a B-tree or balanced tree. It has a single root node at the top of the structure. It can have one or more intermediate levels, and then it has the leaf level, which contains the data pages. The pages on both the intermediate as well as the leaf level form a double linked list, with each page having a pointer to the next and previous page in the list. That allows you to both seek the index from top to bottom, as well as scan the index following the pages in the leaf level in their logical order. Seeking an index and scanning an index are two most typical data access operations that you will see in your execution plans. On our tables, we can also create constraints. Constraints that are available in Oracle and SQL Server are almost exactly the same. So both database platforms offer not null, unique, primary key, foreign key, default, and check constraints. There are some small syntax differences, but generally the functionality of constraints is almost identical. Now let's look at triggers. Trigger functionality between Oracle and SQL Server differs a little bit. The most important differences here are that SQL Server does not offer before triggers. However, SQL Server offers instead of triggers that can be used to implement a very similar functionality, and they can mimic the behavior of before triggers found in Oracle. Also, SQL Server triggers are always statement level, so they always process all the changes performed by a single statement. You don't process row by row, but process all the changes from one statement. That means your trigger needs to be written in a way that allows it to handle multi-row operations. In SQL Server, you can define order of triggers, but only the first and the last trigger to fire. So you can designate which trigger is the first one and which one is the last one, but you cannot specify the full order of triggers. You can, of course, have multiple triggers per action, and you can have multi-action triggers. So you can have a single trigger that handles insert, update, and delete operations. SQL Server offers also data definition language triggers, allowing you to capture operations such as create table or create index. And it offers logon triggers that fire every time a user logs into the database engine. Let's now look at the index structures that are available in Oracle in SQL Server. This table offers detailed comparison between those two. So as you can see, you can have both unique and non-unique triggers in SQL Server and in Oracle. You can have composite triggers, although the number of columns that are allowed in the index key is smaller in SQL Server, and your index keys are limited to 16 columns or 900 bytes. Your triggers can have their keys in ascending and descending order, and you can also have, of course, the clustered indexes. SQL Server does not offer reverse key or key compressed triggers, and it only offers function-based triggers through the use of computed columns. So, of course, you can have a function and then use this function to create a computed column inside SQL Server, and that computed column can be indexed, provided that the computed column, the function, is deterministic. SQL Server does not offer explicit bitmap indexes. You cannot create your own bitmap indexes and perform bitmap joins. However, the SQL Server optimizer can create those indexes on the fly and perform bitmap joins in certain situations. The typical scenario is a star join found in many data warehouse queries. In addition to that, SQL Server 2012 offers a column store index. A column store index is a completely new data structure in SQL Server 2012, and it stores columns rather than rows of data. That allows for some great performance improvements for certain types of queries, and gives us a much better data compression thanks to the collocation of column values in the same column segment. Both Oracle and SQL Server offer various types of views, from simple views based on simple queries to more complex views, including materialized views. SQL Server calls materialized views indexed views, and these are the only indexed, these are the only views in SQL Server that actually store the data. When you create, when you materialize a view in SQL Server, you create a clustered index on your view, and that builds a B-tree containing the data from your view. That B-tree will be maintained like any other index every time the data in the source table, in the underlying base table, is updated. That functionality is very similar to the Oracle's materialized views. SQL Server 2012 also introduces sequences, very similar to Oracle sequences. The functionality was actually designed to mimic that of Oracle in order to improve compatibility between those two data platforms. Also, both Oracle and SQL Server offer synonyms that can point to a different object. Let's now take a look at various data types found in both Oracle and SQL Server. Let's start with the character-based data types, in other words, strings. Both Oracle and SQL Server offer non-Unicode as well as Unicode data. So you have char and nchar as well as varchar and nvarchar in both database platforms. There are some small differences in capacity of those two data types between Oracle and SQL Server. SQL Server also has varchar max and nvarchar max data types. that are used to store very large values, up to 2 gigabytes in size for one value. Those are the new data types that should be used in instead of the older text and text data types. They map into Oracle CLOP and NCLOP data types. Let's now take a look at the numeric data types. The numeric data types in Oracle, most of them are implemented through the number data type. SQL Server offers a larger variety of specialized numeric data types. So you have 4 types of integers in SQL Server, from tiny integer to big integer, with tiny integer storing values in a single byte, small integer storing 2 bytes, integer storing 4 bytes, and big integer storing 8 bytes. It also has decimal and numeric data types, which are actually synonyms for the same data type, equivalent of the Oracle number data type. Both platforms also offer a float data type. And SQL Server also has a bit data type, which is a single bit integer. So it can store a value of 0 or 1 or, of course, null. Let's now take a look at the temporal data types, so date and time. SQL Server used to have just 2 temporal data types: small date time and datetime. Those data types would store both the date and the time portion of the date, and they were of course somewhat limited in both the range of the allowed values as well as the precision of the values that you could store in those data types. In SQL Server 2005, Microsoft introduced Datetime 2, which is a newer version of the old datetime data type, offering larger range of values and higher precision, up to 7 digits for fractional second parts. It also has a datetime offset, which is identical to datetime 2, but it also stores the time zone information. In addition to that, SQL Server also has separate date and separate time data types for storing just the date and just the time. Those are the most important temporal data types in SQL Server today. When it comes to binary data types and storing binary objects, Oracle offers a blob data type, which is equivalent of the SQL Server var binary max. Var binary max can hold up to 2 gigabytes of data in a single value. SQL Server also has the image data type, which is deprecated. It's an older data type that was superseded by var binary max. SQL Server also has var binary max with a file stream modifier. That is somewhat similar to the Oracle's B file. The advantage of storing your binary data as a file stream data in SQL Server is that it offers you a dual programming model. You can treat this data as both a column value in the database as well as a file in the file system. So depending on the needs of the application, you can either query for the value using Transact SQL, or you can retrieve a file handle and open the file as a normal file from the file system. That dual programming model has great advantages when it comes to dealing with large binary files. Apart from that, SQL Server also offers a limited data types, binary with a specific length, and var binary with a specific length. Let me now show you how we can create a table in SQL Server, taking advantage of some of the functionality we've just discussed. I will also show you how we can create a partitioned table with multiple separate partitions. So let's start by creating a simple table in AdventureWorks 2012 database. We are creating a table called Sales Customer Feedback. As you can see, it has four columns, customer feedback ID integer, customer ID also integer, feedback comments, which is NText, so it's a large Unicode data type, and comment date, which is a comment, which is a date type column. That table will also have a primary key clustered constraint, which means the primary key here will be enforced by the means of a clustered unique index, which also means that the table will be an index organized table in the Oracle terminology. And we create this table on the primary file group. So let's create this table. We can also add a check constraint to it and a foreign key constraint. So let's start by adding a foreign key constraint for the customer ID column, referencing a customer ID column in the customer table. So this adds a foreign key constraint to this table. This syntax here makes sure that the foreign key column, the foreign key constraint is actually enforced. We can also create an index, a non-clustered index on this table. So by creating an index on my newly created table on the customer ID and comment date column here. And I create this index on the AW 2012 IDX file group. So I create the index on the file group separate from the one where the table itself was created. We can now verify that this table was created by taking a look in my Object Explorer. So if I open AdventureWorks 2012 tables, I should have sales.customerfeedback table right here with all the columns that I requested, with the foreign key and the primary key and the non-clustered index created. So this is how you create a simple table in SQL Server 2012. Now let's do something a little bit more complicated. So let's now create a partition table. A partition table will have a separate partition for each calendar quarter, and the data in the table will be partitioned by quarter, with each quarter going to a separate file group and a separate file within that file group. So I start by creating a bunch of file groups that will receive my data, and adding a one file to each of the file groups. That way, my database will be prepared to store the data for each separate partition in separate files. So with that, I created a number of files, and now I have to prepare all the functionality that is needed to partition my my table. In order to partition a table in SQL Server 2012, you need two things. You need a partition function and a partition scheme. A partition function is used to designate values that delineate your partitions. So basically, these are boundary values for each of the partitions. In this case, I have 14 values 14 boundary values. And range right means that the boundary value belongs to the right partition. This is what you typically do for partitions that are based on date time and date. So basically, the first partition will be all the dates that are before 1st of July 2001. And then from the 1st of July 2001 up till 1st of October, but not including the 1st of October, that would be the second partition, and so on and so forth, with each of the boundary values belonging to the right partition. Since I'm creating 14 boundary values here, there will be 15 partitions. So with 14 boundary values, I get 15 partitions. So I create the partition function. This partition function describes how the data should be partitioned. The next thing I need is a partition scheme. And the partition scheme is used to map all my partitions to individual file groups. So in this case, I am putting each of the partitions in its own separate file group. Of course, I could put all the partitions in one file group if that was the scenario that I need. It's in many cases, you don't need to separate partitions into separate file groups. You just put all of them in a single file group and use them from there. After I created all those individual file groups, I can now create two important things that are needed in order to partition my data. I need a partition function and a partition scheme. Let's start by creating a partition function. Partition function designates the boundary values for each of your partitions. So in this case, each date here specified here will be a boundary value and will belong to the right partition as specified by the range right clause here. So range right means that the boundary value belongs to the right partition, where range left would mean that the boundary value belongs to the left partition. So in this case, I am creating a partition function that has 14 boundary values, which means I will be creating 15 separate partitions for each of the calendar quarters. Once I created the partition function, I now have to create a partition scheme. And a partition scheme is used to map each partition into one of the file groups in my database. So in this case, since I created a separate file group for each of the quarters, I will be putting each partition in its separate quarter, in a separate file group, with the exception of the first partition that I will put in the primary file group. So I am specifying 15 individual file groups here in order to put 15 partitions each in its respective file group. Once I created that partition scheme, I can create my partition table. And creating a partition table is a standard create table syntax, with the only difference being that you create your table specifying the partition function and the column that you want to use for partitioning. So in this case, rather than specifying a single file group, I am specifying a partition scheme that will govern where each of the individual table partitions will be stored. So let's create this table called order history, and we will execute a query that puts some data into that table. We've just put 31,000 rows, and by querying the table and using a special function called partition, and using the partition function, we can see where each of the rows is stored in which partition. And you can see that all the rows actually went to partition number 15, with all the remaining partitions being empty, We can also check that by querying another DMV or catalog view called sys.partitions. For that object. So where object ID equals object ID for sales order history. And you can see that my object, my table, has 15 individual partitions for its index ID 1. And all of those partitions, except for the last one, are empty. So all the rows that I've put there went to a single partition with the remaining 14 partitions still empty and waiting to receive data. Essentially, each partition of this object is its separate B-tree. It's a separate object with a separate allocation unit and separate B-tree in its own separate file group. You use partitioning in order to provide better management and easier manageability of your data. Partitioning can improve availability of your data by allowing to archive the data using partition switch or loading of the data into, for instance, a data warehouse by using partition switching. So you can load the data into a staging table, and once you've done, you can switch that partition into your fact table in a data warehouse. Or, as in this scenario, we could, for instance, archive our orders by switching each partition individually. So rather than delete or order all orders that could block the table for a while, we can switch the entire partition into the orders history table. So in this demonstration, you have seen how to create a simple table and how to create a partition table for our data. SQL Server also allows for non-native data types, often called beyond relational. So data that goes beyond the standard relational model that we are familiar with. Those data types include spatial data type, allowing you to store, for instance, geographic coordinates. Spatial data type in SQL Server comes in two flavors, geography and geometry. Geography is used to store geographical coordinates from a round Earth model, where geometry is used to store shapes on a flat surface. So you can, for instance, store various geometric shapes and drawings in such a data type. In addition to that, SQL Server also offers another data type called hierarchy ID. That data type is used to store organizational structures and bills of materials. So whenever you want to have some kind of hierarchy, might be a bill of material for your product, it might be your organizational structure in your company, you can use this data type to store the references between all the various nodes in such hierarchy. Those two data types, so actually three, geography, geometry, and hierarchy ID, are implemented in SQL Server using SQL CLR. In other words, they are not natively implemented in SQL Server, rather they are kind of extensions to the standard relational model. SQL CLR allows you to write your own data types as well. So basically, you create a C# class describing the functionality that you need, and you can instantiate an object of this class, and then you can serialize that object to be stored inside the database. And that allows you to build, to extend the functionality of SQL Server and create your own non-native data types. And spatial data types, as well as hierarchy ID, are example of such data types implemented and provided by Microsoft. Let's now take a look at the geographical data type. So in this demo, I would like to show you spatial data and how you can create simple queries querying some of the spatial information. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to declare three simple variables using a geometry data type. Into each of those geometry data types, I'm going to put some data using a standard text representation. So basically, I will initialize each of those data types by parsing this text and creating an appropriate instance of the geometry data type. So as you can see, I'm creating three polygons here. If I then select all those three data types together, all those three shapes together, what you see in the results is a large binary string. What we are seeing here in the results tab is actually the binary representation of a serialized geometry class. But SQL Server Management Studio is smart enough to recognize the fact that those data types or those binary values represent spatial data, and it offers us an extra tab here called Spatial Results. And this Spatial Results tab provides us with a graphical representation of the shapes that are stored in my three geometry values. I could also perform various queries manipulating those data types. I could look for intersections, I could create buffers around them, I could calculate distances, etc., etc. Having geometry and geography in as data types available in SQL Server allow you to store, for instance, address information and perform many geographical queries inside the database. SQL Server also offers spatial indexing, so you can create indexes on this data to speed up those types of queries. So in this demonstration, you have seen some simple geometrical data type as an example of beyond relational data. Finally, let's take a look at the Oracle and SQL Server block-level organization. So what we have here is a comparison of a SQL Server data page versus Oracle data block. As you can see, this organization is very similar. The difference is that SQL Server stores row offsets at the bottom of the page, and it kind of fills the page top to bottom, where Oracle stores row offsets right after the block header, and it fills the data from bottom to the top. So it kind of fills the data block from the bottom, adding new rows and adding appropriate row offsets in the page header. So it's a very similar concept. The difference is very small, and it only has to do with storing the rows in different order on the physical data page. So in this module, we looked at the various table types, data types, and index structures available in SQL Server and in Oracle. We've also compared triggers, constraints, and views. We've looked at the data types, both native and non-native, and compared SQL Server versus Oracle block data storage. Thank you very much for watching, and see you in Module 5, where we will look at some of the programmability and data access methods available in SQL Server.